service, would like to just remind you that our goal for the Psalm study is to memorize at least this verse, because this is the theme. Psalm 1:1, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. So try to put that in memory. And this is really the theme, the foundation of the book of Psalms. As believers, we want to do what's right. We're seeing a lot of what's wrong in the world today. People responding incorrectly, even to a tragedy like we saw. But as believers, counsel of the godly, we're not looking for the philosophy of the world today. So let's put that to memory. And let's take our hymn books now, and we'll go to I Belong to the King. The hymn books have been removed because of dust, but they'll be back when we're done. So I don't think we're going to get rid of them. But we didn't want to get, they didn't want to get dust on them. I shouldn't say me. But we have the words up on the board for you. It's just the beginnings.
I'm
chief musician of the Neginah upon the Shemith, or Sheminith, a psalm of David. O Lord, rebuke me not in thine anger, neither chasten me in thy hot displeasure. Have mercy upon me, O Lord, for I am weak. O Lord, heal me, for my bones are vexed. My soul is also sore vexed. But thou, O Lord, how long? Return, O Lord, deliver my soul. O save me for thy mercy's sake. For in death there is no remembrance of thee. In the grave, who shall give thee thanks? I'm weary with my groaning. All the night make I my bed to swim. I water my couch with my tears. My eye is consumed because of grief. It waxeth old because of mine enemies. Depart from me, all you workers of iniquity, for the Lord hath heard the voice of my weeping. The Lord hath heard my supplication. The Lord will receive my prayer. Let all my enemies be ashamed and sore vexed. Let them return and be ashamed suddenly. May God bless us with those passages of Scripture. I'm going to explain some of the things in the passage there that will make more sense to us as we look at that. But, as we go to prayer this morning, continue to pray for my grandson, Zach. And is he doing better, Mark?
Yeah, he's just not too happy being casted.
Okay. If you are interested, Mark can show you a picture, but he's in a body cast, legs spread out like this. So, you know, there's not a lot of wiggle movement, and he doesn't really understand why he's that way. I think they're under some kind of pain management as well. So if you pray for Zach, pray for Mom and Dad, Renee and Daniel, because they have to deal with that. And we're praying that the hips will be okay at the end. They straightened out, or they lengthened one of the legs, or made the legs even, I guess is the best way to explain it. And hoping one day that Zach will be able to walk. Could you pray for Justine and the family as they grieve the loss of their brother? And I think they're back in Long Island now. They had made the trip out to Oklahoma. Continue to pray for somebody cleaning my pulpit. Could have been my wife. Anybody have a prayer request? Yes.
It's been sent to Stony Brook Hospital.
Okay.
They can't really determine yet. They're doing a lot of testing at home, but of course we can't see him. A relative that works there has been able to drop in on him. Just continue prayer for him.
Justine might be able to check in on because she works at the leisure she's back to work. Mary?
Jared sent me a message. He wanted so much to come, but he said he's so much pain with his back, he's not being able to go to the clinic because it's closed to get his treatment. So that's why he hasn't been coming.
Mark's coming to a specialist on Friday. So we're praying that maybe she'll be able to find out what's going on with him, with that constant itch.
I talked to Ronnie yesterday, and Raj has kind of like a psoriasis, right? Mm-hmm. But that's inflamed as well, and so his back is covered. He had, it went away for a while. I don't know if it's psoriasis or one of those skin things.
Eczema,
yeah. And that it seemed to be inflamed now, so she's been putting coconut oil chance, a great father for our country, Lord, that you would be with our president, give him wisdom as he tries to put out some fires. And we pray, Lord, that if it's your will, Father, that we might just be in that time sequence now where you come back for us, Father. We call it the rapture, and we're hoping that that might happen. But if not, Father, help us be faithful no matter what happens. We know that you'll never forsake us or leave us. We need strength. We need courage sometimes, Father. We need direction. We pray that your Holy Spirit would minister to us. And we pray for little Zach, Father, that you would just be with him. We pray that the surgeries went well, and that at the end we'll be able to get him up on his feet. We pray for Dan and Renee, and Lord, that you would just be with them especially. We pray for Christina as well, as they had a surgery coming up for little Isaac, Father, that you would just be with them. You are a church family, Father. Keep us from this flu, and encourage our hearts for your word, Father, and receive your praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, of course, pray for our. I see it on my list now. It's hard to see the list when your eyes are closed. So. He's on my everyday list anyways. All right, let's take our hymn books and go to 443. We're going to sing Under His Wings. Did I say it wrong?
467.
467. Okay, yeah. All right. Nothing has changed. I need to use my office glasses, and I can't see you, so.
Oh,
six, please. Let's pray to God, Father, we pray that you would lead and direct our paths this morning as we listen in on King David opening his heart to thee. We pray, Father, for application in our lives, Lord, that we might grow closer to thee. We pray, Father, that you would give us the attention, the focus, Father, that we might leave this place this morning growing closer to you with a better understanding of your word, Father. We give you the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. I remember Bible college professor saying that, if anything else, pray that the Holy Spirit intervenes for your inadequacies. I thought, well, that doesn't sound right. What are you saying? And what he was really saying was that what we're looking for as pastors is to pass on the word, praying that the Holy Spirit then would couch it in a ministry in each of our own hearts, including myself. Many times when I'm preaching, I'm being preached to myself as well. The Bible reminds me of things. We find ourselves with King David, and if you thought about it for a minute, here's the king of the nation of Israel, and he is on his knees. Matter of fact, he has been overtaken by his own sin. Now, there's a debate in theological circles whether this is David talking about some sin that he had committed, or he is thinking that because of the oppression of the enemy, that he must have done something wrong, or that he is trying to teach us a lesson here. I go with the sin part, because even though he was king, he certainly wasn't perfect. And, you know, you might be thinking, well, what sin did he commit? Because people are always interested in the bad news. But I'm thinking, as a believer, the sin that so easily besets us is the sin that causes the most grief. It doesn't have to be some horrific thing that you've done, but you've violated God's word in some way, whether it is physically or spiritually or emotionally or whatever avenue that we can possibly go against God's word. That sin is what we're looking at David to deal with. So this is a good psalm for us to recognize the need that we cannot become callous to sin. Sometimes people, like, they do horrific things and it's like, oh well, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. And that might be true, but the sin should make an impact in our relationship. Now, whether David sensed there was some estrangement with God in his psalm here, he recognized that there needed to be rebuke. And let me go into the passage and I'll share it with you as I flesh this out. I did have an introduction that I might share with you, but in a nutshell, this goes back way back when people rode trains, not planes. So it's probably, I don't want to age anybody, it's probably in the 50s, 40s or 50s. But anyway, an evangelist was making his way home on a train. He sat down next to a young man, and after a while, he noticed the tears in his eyes. And the young man said to the minister asked him if there was anything he could do for him to help him. And the young man said, "Preacher," and I'm not sure how he knew he was a preacher, but, you know, this is just the story. "2 years ago, I got so mean at home that my mom and dad couldn't do anything with me. By one day, I even went so far as to strike my own father. And dad came up to his son and said, 'I hate to do it. It's going to break mama's heart, but we want you to just get away from here. Just leave the house.' The young man had wandered the country for some time, and 3 weeks earlier, he gave his heart to Christ. He wrote a letter to his parents and told them that he would be coming home on the old train, and he wasn't sure that they would welcome him home, so he told his parents to hang a little rag on top of the apple tree in their yard as a signal that he was forgiven. If there was no rag on the tree, he would just remain on the train and keep on going. And as they approached his house, the young man asked the preacher, can you see if there's a white rag on that old apple tree? And the preacher said, son, you can relax. The apple tree is in full bloom. I've never seen so many white rags tied on anything in all my life. And that's not all, he says. Out under the tree, I see a gray-haired woman and a man standing out there waving a big white sheet, saying, come home, son. Welcome home, we love you. That's exactly what we're seeing here. As believers, when we sin, we break the relationship with God. And when that sin is dealt with, God welcomes us back with open arms. There is forgiveness with the Lord Jesus Christ. And even though King David, yes, he was anointed, this Holy Spirit came upon him, he was king, but he did some things down the road that were against God's word, and we find ourselves looking at David now pleading for mercy in repentance. Now, I like the way David shapes this, and I wish I would have thought of this when I was a kid, when my grandfather was coming after me with a broom, because he said in the song, and I'll tell you what these musical Shemaiah is the word for octave. This was supposed to be played in like a mourning octave. And the other, Nick Oweth, is an eight-string instrument, but it would be toned down. So this would be like a penitent psalm that they would sing in the worship service. You know how that goes. One song you just sang is kind of slow and repentant. And that's exactly what this psalm is all about. I was talking to the boss, my wife, because I asked her theological questions, because she went to Bible school too. She's a very smart woman. And I was asking her, now did David write this psalm for the purpose of just having this hymn in church? Or was this coming from his heart, and that we agree that's where it came from? And then he, I think, led by the Holy Spirit, which is exactly what we see here, something that we can, thousands of years later, relate to. You know, we've been conditioned over the centuries and years that there are degrees of sin, white lies, you know, little things like this. But I find myself falling back into Scripture, noticing that the Bible says, one sin guilty of them all. In God's eyes, because he's holy, one sin is enough. And it's not necessarily a horrific sin. It could be what we would classify as a minor sin. You know, Margaret says, do this jeans make me look heavy? I did that for Matt's sake. Margaret has been losing weight, so I don't know if you've noticed that, but she's, slumming right now. I know where it's going. Me, at night, I get heavier for some reason. You know, anyway, that's a medical miracle, I guess. I should have said that. We're going to look at number one, David's humble supplication. Supplication is an interesting Hebrew word, which has the idea of tears or agony, and lends to the personal petition. This was something that he was dealing with. He didn't have to explain to God what happened, but he was sharing from his heart. It says, he cried out, verse 1 and 2. So let's look at that together. O Lord, rebuke me not in thy anger, neither chasten me in their hot displeasure. So what he's saying is, I accept and I know that I'm going to be rebuked, but I'm looking for mercy. Mama, I know you have to spank me, but can you use the feather instead of the belt?
Yeah.
I wanted it spanked, but I don't want to really, that's an over-exaggeration. But what David is telling us, that this relationship somehow has been broken, and he's looking for a restoration. Now, he has the enemy after him, and a lot of times you might say, and might be right, that God is causing this altercation with, maybe it's his son and other enemies or other enemies, as part of the discipline of David, bringing him back in line. And David might have been looking like this might have been part of the reasoning why, but certainly we find that it had affected him. So he cries out, and someone said, you know, sometimes we kind of hedge around the truth. We, you know, I want to tell Kate that I broke a window, but I'll give him a long story about, you know, the dynamics of things and how things accidentally break. And Kate was to say, why didn't you just tell me the window's broke so I can fix it? You know, so anyway, sorry to use you as an example, Kate, but you know, this is how we are. But the writer said that David recognized God's omniscience and didn't hedge around and just kind of blurted out. Matter of fact, it affected him to the point where he cried out and he was looking for mercy. He knew that he was being chastised. And, David realized his only course of action, his only hope in the situation was to plead for mercy. He had no desire to experience the rebuke of God or his chastening hand in displeasure. So we find that David cries. His condition is revealed in verses 2 and 3. It says, have mercy upon me, O Lord, for I am weak. And that's another definition of supplication in Hebrew. It affected them. I'm weak, O Lord, I am weak. Heal me, for my bones are vexed. Now, if you jump up to about 50th verses, David deals with his sin with Bathsheba and mentions the fact that his very bones were affected, shaking. And think about it for a second. I said in the beginning that it seemingly is a trend to be callous toward our relationship to God as far as his disciplining us. You know, God is love, he loves us, you know. And that is very true, but God is very just as well. And I used to tell my kids, and my grandfather said the same thing. One, he said, this is going to hurt me more than it's going to hurt you, which I never believed. And when he spanked me, I didn't see him cry, I don't think. But he did it because he loved me. And God, certainly as a good father, has taught us through the scriptures that a good father will not spare the rod. And if we look at our relationship with God as an ongoing, living relationship, the last thing we want to do is to foul it up with sin. So we don't want to allow ourselves to desensitize ourselves to sin. We have to recognize that and deal with it. We're going to look at that as we go through the passage here, what we have as an occasion for believers in the dispensation of grace. But David did the same thing. He recognized it, cried out for mercy, and it affected him. But something that I think that most people don't recognize today is there's a conviction. Verse 4 says, return, O Lord, deliver me, my soul. O save me for thy mercy's sake. David is weeping and looking at his sin as serious enough that God could send him to the grave. Some people say that, you know, a believer, God will only allow him to go so far and then sometimes take him home early, you know. I'm not sure how I can articulate it in Scripture, but that might be very true. But for us as believers, what we want to have is that communication. I remember reading a story about a World War II event that was happening. And back then, they didn't have cell phones. They had landlines. Matter of fact, when I was in the Army National Guard, we still had them strung out everywhere. And I guess that was before cell phones, too, then, wasn't it? I guess I'm aging myself. But these landlines were the only communication to you and to the back, wherever the leaders were hiding, you know. And that's where we called in the sorties and the whatever those other things were that flew over our heads and hoped they landed on us, those type of things. And so that landline is important. So that was something that was concealed, but was precious. And there were guys, men that were, that was their whole job, to make sure these things were connected. And so if you look at it from that perspective, when one sins, you lose that connection with prayer. And that's the last thing that you want to experience, is not being able to pour out your heart to God. And the Holy Spirit's ministry then is to convict us. And it can happen that after a while, if you're willing to accept that behavior as I just can't help it. There becomes a catalyst there. And then God can't minister because our communication is broken. I feel that David is really revealing to us the need to have this, to the point where he was anguishing about what was going on. He was convicted. He wanted God to return him. He wanted that place again. Now, David was probably in a cave hiding from his enemies. He could have seriously justified whatever behavior he had. His behavior, sin, could have been just now. Why is God allowing this to happen? How many of us have ever questioned God's decision-making? You know, something happens. What's going on? I thought you were supposed to protect me. We sometimes are, tunnel vision, because all we see is our lives. And if you read the Bible long enough, you'll find out that the Bible includes us all as a family. We're linked in God's will. And what I go through sometimes might just be to help someone else. Think of our brother Joe and all he went through, and how many people his example helped along the pathways of history when people were recognizing the fact that there is nothing they have done, yet they're going through some difficulty. The disciples were the ones that were praising the Lord as they were chained to big, brutish guards, thinking that, wow, what a neat thing to be allowed the privilege to suffer for Christ. So we really kind of have to turn the tables on our thinking as we look at our personal lives, as we spin our ways and our days. There's a verse in the Bible that says we're accountable for our time. Take every moment as a precious opportunity, basically, is what the verse says. I can't think of what the verse is. And I didn't write it down for Mark, so we'll just go on from there. And we find in verse 5 David's concern. And now, some very bad commentators, I wouldn't waste my money, said that here David's saying that after death there's nothing. It's annihilation. See, this is the verse. And if this was the only verse that David ever wrote, you might make a case, but David in several other places talk about being in glory, being God's presence after death. But he says, for in death there's no remembrance of thee. In the grave, who shall give thee thanks? What David was saying is that once he's dead, this opportunity to worship him is gone. This relationship was so real to David that David didn't want to die because of punishment. So the mercy kicks in. He's looking for mercy. Actually, it's a challenge that presents us as well. We only have one life and one opportunity to praise the Lord here and make a difference. I have two verses I want to show you. The first one is Isaiah 38:19. The living, he shall praise thee, and as I do this, the Father to the children shall be made known thy truth. So we have one chance in life to communicate the truth to our children and others and to praise the Lord. Now the second verse, really, I got from Keith. Because I'm standing watching Keith finagle a letter. All of us would be like thinking, what is he doing? Trying to get this spot. He's trying to scrape something back there that no one can see. And when I question him, I say, why are you doing this? No one's going to see that. And he says, everything he does, he's doing for the Lord, and it has to be done right. And that reminded me of a verse. So thank you, Keith. Ecclesiastes 9. Whatever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might. For there is no work, nor device, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave, whether thou knowest. One chance to shine for God. And, people say, well, you're the janitor. What can you do? Well, the janitor can make the church shine for glory. Make that toilet so clean you can eat a sandwich. That's the attitude we should take. No one's going to test that theory, but I think that as a challenge, we have to recognize that God has given us one chance as believers to put Him first and to do every little thing correctly as if God was there standing. So I understand what Keith was saying. Now, He didn't quote the person. He didn't have to. But his attitude was, you know, maybe I'm going to do it anyway, so leave me alone. But I got the impression that, you know, this was important to him because this is God's house. And even though we can't see it, he's got it right, as far as I can tell. Number two, David's honest confession. So we have David's humble supplication. David's honest confession is found in verse 6 and 7. He says, I'm weary with my groaning. Now, you could put meditation there or something else, you know, but what he was saying is he was weary with groaning all the night long. I make my bed to swim. I water my couch with my tears. It's a hyperbolic device used in poetry. He didn't cry that much that his bed was soaking, but what he is trying to tell us that his tears were significant. You know, I had this, where is it here? I did some research on tears. Oh, yeah, here it is. Tears are beneficial concerning our emotional well-being. Tears are your body's release valves for stress, sadness, grief, anxiety, frustration. Medical studies also show that tears are beneficial concerning our physical well-being. Tears protect our eyes, they supply lubrication, remove irritants, reduce stress hormones, and they contain antibodies that fight pathogenic microbes. It is also clear through the scriptures that tears are beneficial concerning our spiritual well-being. We shed tears of joy when we are in a right relationship with the Father. We shed tears as a result of burden for the lost people. We shed tears when we reach a place of brokenness and seek to return to the Father. So we have David's example here. And I can make the case in the scriptures to show you each one of David's events where he was dancing before the Lord, his tears of joy, and, you know, tears of his brothers. No, that was Joseph. So that would have worked too, but that's not David. But there's other examples that are flying away as I speak of David communicating to us this relationship that we have. When's the last time you cried for someone that was lost in their sins? You become callous. Well, I've heard too many people say, I'm glad I'm saved. I don't care about anybody else. They didn't say that in those words, but their attitude is the same way because I ain't going to talk to him about Christ. He might punch me, right? They might laugh at me. Or, you know, it's a little inconvenient right now. I'll wait till they're on their deathbed. That's a better time, right? So, you know, we have to look at our own personal lives because no one here has any place to judge anyone else. We have to look personally and think, Lord, you've given me so much. How can I give back? And I pray every day that God would give me opportunities to share Christ. It doesn't come all the time, but when it does, I jump at the chance just to plant the seed in your heart. And David's honest confession here, you know, they say in history, those that write it never talk about their warts. You know what that means? No one in their right mind is going to talk about the night they went to bed. I'm a leader. I'm not going to say anything like that. They're not going to be there. They're not going to talk about their weaknesses. They're not going to reveal their wash. And that's why when someone says that, the Bible is not true, I say one of the factors that I look at as I look at Scripture is that Israel recorded their good and their bad. No king wants you to be remembered as the king that dropped the ball, you know, failed in this. Yet we find David opening his heart to the readers and to the worshipers about how he felt about his own personal sin and how he led the pathway down as we confessed it honestly. It affected him. He was weary. Verse 7 says he was weak. He says, my eye is consumed because of grief. It waxes old because of my enemies. He's crying. He's confused. He's turning to the only one he can turn to is God. And I find direct application with this. What do? We don't know what to do. And we're hands are tied. We have no recourse. The person, the loved one, the event is out of our hands. But David says he goes to where it can be affected. He goes to the Father. He pleads for mercy. And he finds it. His enemies, in the last four chapters that we've looked at, chapters and Psalms, sometimes they would say, God is not on his side. God is for us. And David hears that. You know, it's like someone telling you, don't bother praying. He don't listen to your prayers. You're too much of a sinner. He's not going to accept you. You've done too many bad things. That's happened in the past. Yet the Bible reveals to us that God is ready, always, waiting for his son to come home. We know the New Testament example of the son that went to the father and said, look, give me my inheritance. I want to go, and I left. What do we call him? The prodigal son. And the son goes to the point where he's at the end of his rope. He's eating corn husks with the pigs. He decides to think, he thought that if I could go home to dad, I could be a servant and at least have a clean meal and a bed to lay on, and went home. And we know the story of the father seeing him far off and preparing things for him. And what a celebration. And, you know, the story is clouded with the older son and all that, but I'm looking at just this one part because I know no matter what happens, I have a Father in heaven who is waiting for me all the time with open arms. Sin is a serious thing. It has to be dealt with. But God is faithful and just. We're going to look at a verse here in a second as we look at David's heartened acclamation. And what I mean by that is this is right from the heart. He makes this statement, verse 8. Depart from me, all ye workers of iniquity, for the Lord hath heard the voice of my weeping. His faith is there. Depart from me, all ye workers of iniquity, for the Lord has heard my voice. The voices of judgment and condemnation were strong formed from the adversaries of David. They did not have final say. This is not a denial of guilt on David's part, but a statement of hope and rejoicing. Remember at the beginning I said that he was accepting the rebuke, but he just wanted to be handled in God's mercy. So as believers, when we sin, which is because of the sin nature, something that we have to deal with, because of 1 John 2:2, and he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the whole world. The next one, if we confess. Now, this is for the believer today. If we acknowledge our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. When that point comes where you get on your knees and say, God, forgive me. Lord, I know this was wrong. And I'm with a contrite heart, a broken heart, I'm seeking forgiveness. He forgives us. Just like the mom and dad there, waiting for the son to come home. All things forgiven. What does it say? All. From all unrighteousness, he cleans us up. That's a wonderful benefit. Now, when you came to Christ, all your sins were taken care of. So, what sin is this? This is the sin that dirties us in the world, where we are filthy from the world, and he cleans us up and sets us back. Now, David will share with us that there's going to be rebuke. Your sin will be forgiven, will be cleansed.